Today, I'm going to tell you about a new technique where you can make functional quantum devices by printing them exactly where you want them to be. The whole process can be done in a few minutes, but the best part is that you do everything in an electron microscope. So first, I'm going to tell you about our devices, which are based on something called the Josephson junction. If you're familiar with that, you can go ahead and skip to the next part. Otherwise, here's a quick intro. So to put it simply, a Josephson junction is when you have two superconductors that are separated by some form of weak link. Now this weak link can be many things. It can be a normal metal, it could be an insulating barrier or a constriction. What is crucial is that the weak link must be able to couple the two superconductors together by allowing their wave functions to overlap. You could also think of this as two reservoirs of Cooper pairs which leak into the weak link and make it also superconducting. As a consequence, now you can pass a finite amount of supercurrent through your Josephson junction. But this supercurrent is not driven by a voltage like in conventional electronics. No, the supercurrent is driven by the difference in the phases of the two superconducting wave functions. Now, if you're new to quantum mechanics, you can think of this phase like this. If the wave function was an actual wave, its amplitude would be how tall this wave is, and the phase would tell you where you are on the wave. Are you on a high or a low, for instance? Now, the phase plays a crucial role here because it introduces a wave-like nature to your electrical transport, which is similar to that of light, in fact. For instance, if you apply a magnetic field to your Josephson junction and measure the supercurrent, you will see the same Fraunhofer diffraction pattern as you would in the single-slit experiment in optics. Similarly, if you connect two Josephson junctions in parallel, you'll have a double-slit interference pattern. But what this means is that you can now do highly sensitive quantum interferometry measurements with an electronic device. But how do you make a device like this? Well, usually this is a multi-step process which needs to be carefully engineered and could take days to complete. In almost every single case, you'll need to combine lithography with other thin film processing techniques. Now, these practices impose some unavoidable restrictions on the type of system that you can use Josephson junctions for. For instance, you always need to have a very flat surface that can undergo spin coating. You also need to have a system that is robust and stable enough to be dipped in all kinds of chemicals and solvents. And often you also have to heat up your sample and bombard it with energetic ions. What we wanted to do was to bypass all these practices using a direct write approach known as electron beam-induced deposition, or EBID for short. The way that EBID works is that you inject some form of a precursor molecule, usually a metal organic compound, into the chamber of a scanning electron microscope. These molecules are stable until you expose them to the focused electron beam, at which point they dissociate and form a deposit on the surface. In our case, that would be tungsten carbide. Now, if you scan your beam carefully, you could also go out of plane and print 3D structures with EBID. EBID is not a new technique. In fact, it's been around since the 90s, and people have used it to make fantastic looking structures like the ones you see here. Unfortunately, when it came to the electronic properties, these structures turned out to be pretty useless. You see, because of the high level of disorder and contaminants in these EBID structures, they all show highly resistive behavior. Nevertheless, there were a lot of efforts to make disordered superconductors with EBID. The prime example being tungsten carbide, which can have a transition temperature of about 5 or 6 Kelvin. Most of these studies showed the resistance to go up by lowering the temperature, and they found no sign of a superconducting transition. In fact, when we started, there was one study where the author succeeded in making superconducting tungsten carbide, but the transition temperature was about 2 Kelvin. And this was widely believed to be the limit of what EBIT can provide. Now you see, sometimes being new to a field can work in your favor because you start to play around with parameters that normally people wouldn't. And this is pretty much what happened in our case. Because one day, my bachelor student back then, Tycho, you'll meet him later in the video, he came to me and said he's made a superconducting tungsten carbide wire with a transition temperature of about 2.5 Kelvin, which was already higher than the previous reports. When we looked into it, we found that Tycho had been using much higher beam currents than the previous reports. And, well, for the next month or so, we optimized the other parameters. At the end, we managed to get the transition temperature to be about 5 Kelvin, which is a comfortable temperature to work with. More importantly, however, we noticed that depending on how we scan the electron beam, we can control the electrical properties of the tungsten carbide. For instance, if we scan the beam slowly, we will have superconducting tungsten carbide. But if we do it fast, then we'll have metallic, but not superconducting, tungsten carbide. And this provided us with the means to make our Josephson junctions. So this is how we did it. We first deposit two superconducting tungsten carbide wires, which are separated by about 150, 160 nanometers. And then we connected them using a metallic tungsten carbide piece, which was deposited at a faster rate. Now, one thing that was surprising to us was how reproducible this process is. For the same parameters of EBIT, we always got the same critical current. But I guess there are two approaches to get reproducible results. One is to go to the clean limit, where you try to minimize impurities and defects, and the other is the other extreme is to go to a disordered system which is already dirty and therefore robust to day-to-day variations in the impurity level. Now you can find full details about how we make the junctions and our transport measurements in our manuscript, which I will provide the link in the description below. But for now, we're going to go to the lab and do an actual demonstration. This is the fun part. So I'm joined now by Tycho, and we're going to go down to the lab and print a full Josephson junction. And we're going to start the timer to see how long it takes from start to finish. As you notice, we're both wearing masks. That's because of the pandemic. Well, in my case, it's actually because everyone tells me I look better with a mask on. Yeah, kind of hurts. Right.
So this is where we'll be printing our devices today. It's a silicon chip with some gold contacts on top, which we can later connect wires to for our electrical measurements. I've glued this using a carbon paint, and I think it's dried now. So let's go ahead and load our sample.
Right, so after loading the sample, we had to wait for about 5 minutes for the chamber pressure to go down. And now Tycho is focusing the electron beam. So maybe I can tell you a little bit about how the scanning electron microscope actually works. you get an electron beam and you focus it into a tiny, tiny spot. Now, wherever you shine your beam, you're going to excite some secondary electrons from your sample, which you can detect. So now you can scan your beam in tiny increments and pixel by pixel measure how many secondary electrons come out of your sample. And this way you can construct a full image of your surface. But this scanning procedure happens so fast that you barely notice it. In fact, it feels almost real time looking at your sample. And the resolution of this technique is about 5 to 10 nanometers, which is great because later we're going to use this imaging aspect of the microscope to position our devices exactly wherever we want them to be. So, for instance, if we have a magnetic particle somewhere that we want to measure, we could first use the imaging part of the microscope to locate, to find a magnetic particle, and the next part will go and write our device right next to it, exactly where we want our measurements to be carried out.
All right, I'm done focusing now, and we want to deposit our structure on these four wires, which we're later going to use for electrical transport measurements.
Yeah, so these are basically just gold contacts where we're going to use these two for passing the current through our samples, and we'll measure these two for measuring the voltage. But basically, they're just wires.
All right, I'm going to insert the needle to inject the precursor gas.
Okay.
There it is.
All right. Gets pretty close to the surface.
It does. Now we're going to deposit our two superconducting wires, one and two, and these are separated by a 160 nanometer gap.
That's this bit, right?
Yes.
Okay.
So we're all set?
Okay, let me time it. I'm going to actually start a timer now.
All right.
All ready, set, go. So now we've started scanning the beam and you're also flooding the system with your precursor molecule.
Exactly.
How long is this bit supposed to take?
This is about 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
It's important to note that we're using a pretty high electron beam current. I think we're using 20 nanoamp, right?
Exactly, yeah. And that's very high with respect to previous reports. Usually they only go up to somewhere around 5 nanoamps.
Yeah, but it also makes sense to us because higher beam current means that you have more electrons. And if you think about it, for each molecule, you have to break 6 bonds. So you need to have 6 electrons per molecule for effective dissociation. But the downside, of course, is that with a higher beam current, you also have a larger beam spot size. So your resolution goes down. You use a smaller beam spot size, your structure is also smaller.
Yeah. Now we've printed the two superconducting tungsten carbide wires, and we're gonna fill in this gap in between with metallic tungsten carbide.
Right, so that would be this square.
Yes.
That's the green square, okay. Right, all set.
All set, let's play. Okay, we're done now.
All right, 14 minutes and 39 seconds. Let's see how it looks like. Nice. And that's the complete device. We're done.
Okay, now the question is, how do you know this is a Josephson junction? Well, unfortunately, I don't have enough time to explain all of that in this video. But a good example is when you irradiate these junctions with microwaves, in which case you see quantized steps in the current voltage characteristics. And the height of these steps is exactly equal to the frequency of your microwaves times Planck's constant over 2E, the charge of electrons. And I think that's just beautiful for something that you printed in less than an hour, that you could load it into a cryostat and immediately see quantum transport. You can find out more about our Josephson transport and those experiments in our manuscript, but the bottom line here is that this is a very simple method to make simple devices, but these devices can be easily integrated into very complex systems. We've already made squid magnetometers with this and are currently working towards printing 3D structures, and that would be really exciting, because it would open up a whole lot of new possibilities for superconducting devices and their applications.
Right, I hope you enjoyed the video.
If you have any questions, please write me an email or write in the comment section below, and I'll try to get back to you as soon as I can. This has been Late Night Physics with Kaveh. Till next time.